Jellyfish. Jellyfish are one of the oldest and most delicate of all living animals. Delicate because there are no hard parts that make up their body. To find a fossil jellyfish is one of the most extraordinary discoveries in paleontology. Hello, I'm Ron Meyer. My fossil collecting partner, Jerry Gunderson, and myself did just that. We found 430 million-year-old fossil jellyfish and some other creatures never seen before. In fact, the rarest fossils are fossils that preserve soft tissue. When you think about it, almost all life is made up of soft tissue. Bacteria, algae, worms, the skin on your body, the guts, muscles, and connecting tissue of virtually every animal. So to find a fossil site that preserves soft tissue is always the most exciting and important in paleontology. These sites are called Lagerstätte.
These kinds of exceptional preservation are really important for us paleontologists who are trying to understand the history of life, because otherwise we only have the shells and bones and teeth, the biomineralized material, and that just gives us, you know, maybe 40% at best, so perhaps 60% of any biota is going to be soft body. So without that information, you've only got part of the story.
What is known as the Big Hill Lagerstätte is located in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan and the heavily forested area of the Stonington Peninsula. However, 430 million years ago, everything was quite different.
So 430 million years ago, it was very different from what we have here now. I mean, today it's very cold, but back then it was tropical. It was south of the equator, maybe by 10 degrees, and hurricanes were part of the weather, and that was the reason some of these things show up. It's the storms coming through. The water that they were in was warm. This is why we find corals sometimes in periods like this, where today you wouldn't find corals growing in our lakes in the Michigan area. This area was ocean, but it was actually close to the Canadian craton. That is, the Canadian shield was sticking up to the north, and that a rock created a shoreline, and so what we are is maybe 100 miles from maybe where there was a shore, and maybe even closer, and it was quite shallow, and it was probably a lagoon. It was quiet, and not much was going on except when a storm would roll in. So cephalopods might float in here and be dropped off, but they might have been living further out in the deep sea.
Modern-day nearshore oceanic lagoons and tidal pools are some of the most life-rich ecosystems on the planet, teeming with life. They are where early evolution took place.
The Big Hill Lagerstätte, it's not the most diverse Lagerstätte, and it's obviously not quite as, it's not going to capture the mind as much as stuff like Burgess Shale does, but it's very, very important in telling us what's going on at this period of time and showing us what's happening in these more restricted, marginal environments when the focus that we're getting a lot of the time is what's going on in the oceans. And these kind of shallow environments where there's much more environmental stress going on, that's going to act as a driver for innovation and evolution. And so it's really critical that we're getting this kind of view from Big Hill, because we don't get a lot of that from the other Lagerstätte that we've got.
Our fossil collecting adventure at Big Hills began in the fall of 2013. One of the first fossils we found was a creature like this. Then we found a slab with multiple of these animals preserved on it. Remarkably, they came in different sizes. It blew our minds. We thought they were Eurypids. Eurypids are often called sea scorpions. They are a very rare extinct arthropod, but it turned out we had found something even rarer.
There were obviously a lot of specimens of what we thought were Eurypterids, and I'd seen multiple photographs of them for all intents and purposes. I just thought they were very bizarre Eurypterids, which you could expect them to be bizarre because it's quite early in the evolutionary history. But then I got up to Wisconsin and I started looking at the material, and then there's one specimen in particular which is preserved on its side. Because it's preserved on its side, I could see this weird split that you wouldn't expect to see on a Eurypterid. And you could see this big plate on the bottom, and then there were three segments on the top. And that is characteristic of this group we call catmatasmidids, a group which we only had one species in the Ordovician before this point, and which we only had about 13 species known globally throughout the entirety of the evolution history, and they're all very, very small. And so I was absolutely blown away when I realized what it was, because it was still a weird arthropod, but it was even weirder than I thought because of the group that it actually belongs to.
Not only were there only a few specimens Chasmatasmidida ever found, but none of them were complete, just fragments. We found over 50 completes of all sizes. Why so many here?
What I think they're doing is they are using the sort of very sheltered environment to molt. We have found areas before where there are groups of catmatasmidids in the Devonian of Germany, where they have come together and molted, and they're sort of, because they're smaller, they're all broken up and fragmented. We know that Eurypterids also would molt in sort of groups. So it seems that they are doing the same kind of basic thing, their behavior. They've come together in a more sheltered area where they're away from any potential predators, maybe even others of their own kind that are not sort of in their molting cycle, so that they can sort of shed their skin and then harden their exoskeleton without having to deal with being attacked.
We found two other marine psilocerates, some of which you might be familiar with. The horseshoe crab that's still living, Eurypterids, which is also known as the sea scorpion. And this group of animals went on to become the arachnids, spiders, mites, chiggers, other things we don't care for too much. But these were the first ones. One of the interesting things about the Eurypterids is that the original skin is on these animals. It's like, you know, if you had a crab or a lobster and you saw the carapace and it was kind of red and bumpy, we find that original material 430 million years old.
We have horseshoe crabs and we have Eurypterids. The horseshoe crabs are very, very rare at Big Hill. But they're fantastic because they look completely different to any other horseshoe crab that we've got in the fossil record. This is also very, very early on in their evolutionary history, and so it's very interesting to see them experimenting with their morphology and maybe adopting different shapes as they're in these slightly unusual environments where you find horseshoe crabs today. We also have the Eurypterids. The Eurypterids are different because we have more than one species, and they seem to be doing different things. We seem to have one that's a very large predator and another one that maybe is sort of raking through the sediment looking for food, and it's quite possible that they've also moved into this environment in order to molt. So the interesting thing about all three of these groups is that they are all sort of on the stem of becoming arachnids. And arachnids, of course, made the transition onto land sometime in the Silurian and then became very, very successful terrestrial predators. We know that horseshoe crabs are able to come up on land for periods of time because modern horseshoe crabs go up onto beaches to lay their eggs. It's also thought that Eurypterids were able to do this as well, and in fact there's evidence from trackways later on in sort of the Carboniferous, almost 200 million years later, that they were able to move between pools because they moved into freshwater environments and they were moving between pools and following the water as it was drying up. And so it's very interesting to see all three of these groups in sort of these more marginal marine environments so early on in the evolutionary history.
What we have in the Big Hill is a window into a complete primordial marine ecosystem. Fossils are not common, and they are spread out over the deposit. However, we found over 40 different species, including brachiopods, ostracods, gastropods, many nautiloids, soft bryozoan, and a variety of primitive non-animal life forms.
Well, the non-animal life, we usually think of them as plants, but they're related to plants. They're algaes. One of the ones that we've been finding are green algaes, and they look just like a horsetail living on the land, and they have little leaves, and there's joints, so they're segmented. We find a kelp-like structures that look like a glove, and they actually have some color to them, and it's not the color of the algae, it's more or less the minerals and the organic matter left behind. One of the things we found were algaes in the form of microbial mats. And if you find them, you would recognize them. They look like the skin of an elephant. It's wrinkled. And What happens is when these things died, or when they were, well, they were actually maybe living on the sea floor and creating a soft, ripply a mat. And as they died, they would multiply and continue to, their thickness. The whole thing would get a little thicker. So we found a couple of microbial mats, and I'm sure there are microbial films here. You actually can see zones where it's raised and it's very, very thin, and it probably were algae's living one cell in a thin film over the surface.
Well, he's getting early algae, and again, they don't preserve well because of their very nature. They don't have any kind of shelly material in them, and I think Big Hill is close enough to land, if indeed these things are terrestrial, or at least they're living in shallow water. So in that sense, they're getting preserved here where they don't necessarily get preserved in other places.
Collecting at this site has not been easy.
So what we have to do here, I'm going to take my pick and just lift. This is the rock right here on the ground, which we have to collect. It's a thin layer, sits on a hard rock, but you'll see that this rock has little places where it's weathered, and I'm going to pull one up. I'm not expecting to find anything, but we take it, we look at it, see if there's anything there, pull up another one, and we keep doing this, and maybe one out of 20 times we find a fossil we're looking for. And now we'll go over to the our other site where we found most of our creatures. This site right here has yielded spectacular Eurypteids with their shells, some nice nautiloids, a strange animal that's kind of like a nautiloid on a stick that nobody's been able to describe. So we'll go to the next site.
This is a typical hard rock pop. What do you got?
It looks like a nautiloid and a chaz. It's related to the Eurypteid.
Wow. That's fantastic, huh?
Yes. This is a new genus, new species at least.
And what's the name? This is one of the main things we've been collecting. And these are the only complete ones ever found, ever.
Yes.
And what's the other thing?
That's a nautiloid, external. And there's a little color pattern on it. This is maybe some of the color that would be in the shell.
So this is not typical. You probably have to turn over, you know, 40 of these to find something.
Yes, the pops are everywhere.
However, the second most common animal in the Big Hill are Medusa. Jellyfish that probably at one time looked like this, lying on the near shore beach of an ancient lagoon. The number of sites where fossil jellyfish have been found number less than 10. In fact, Darwin predicted fossil jellyfish would never be found. We found over 100 specimens.
Well, jellyfish, of course, are interesting animals in terms of their, what we call taphonomy, their preservational history, because as you know, they tend to be, of their very nature, very decay prone. They're kind of jelly, so they decay away pretty rapidly. There are structures in Big Hill and in one or two other localities where it looks as if what might be the umbrella of the jellyfish has a slightly tougher cuticle, and you get quite a lot of these specimens at Big Hill. At the moment, I don't know that you found any that show traces of the tentacles as well, but that might well be something to, you know, keep one's eye out for. But these things, again, may give us more information about the history of a group that's really very poorly represented in the fossil record.
For lifelong fossil collectors like us, collecting the Big Hill site doesn't get any better. And we are still finding new creatures.